It takes a licking and keeps on ticking. It's the Armington Tower at Lakeland Community College. It's been more than 20 years since its grand addition to the campus, and Lakeland's clock tower has increasingly become much more than a simple timepiece. College President Ralph Doty explains.
Well, my personal feeling about the clock itself is that in all of Lake County, there probably is not a more recognizable symbol. It really has given us a trademark, and for that we're grateful. It just makes it a whole lot easier to publicize and promote this campus to have that clock as a symbol.
With the tower symbolizing the progress and mission of the college, the constant mechanical motion of gears and pendulum representing the technologies and sciences, the entire structure stands as a sculpture to represent the arts. Dedicated in October of 1972, Lakeland's prized chronometer has received meticulous care from several local experts. For the past 10 years, Berea machinist Dave Moore has provided the skills necessary to meet the many challenges of maintaining the mechanical masterpiece.
It's always different. One time water got in the hand shaft and froze that up and it stopped all the mechanism. They had to get a bucket truck out here and pull this east dial out the entire hand shaft, and I took that home and rebuilt it. Brought it back, same thing, bucket truck, put it back in. Over the years, it's been failure to strike hands out of sync, odd lot, whatever happens to a clock built in 1913. It's a weight-driven tower clock, regulated by a pendulum, which has a 2-second period of oscillation. It's a compensated pendulum, so it's exceedingly accurate for a clock built in the period. Seth Thomas built it, they're all pretty similar. They all used epicycloidal gears, and when you look at a clock and you say, gee, what's in there? There's only four wheels in there, really, and a pendulum, and then there's motion work to give you the ratio between the hands, the hour, and the 12-hour. There's a lot of little pieces, but essentially it consists of four wheels, a pendulum, and an escapement.
So what happened to it this time?
We're not sure about that, but the pulley that the cable goes up to ring the bell, pulled out of the ceiling with the anchors, came down, and whether that broke the fan fly and caused a failure, but anyway, it hit the hand shaft on the west dial and broke that. And I took that back and got it welded and remachined it, and as you can see, it's back in there, and we're back in business, except for this strike, so we're still working on that.
Built more than 80 years ago, the rugged mechanism was the largest of the Seth Thomas standard tower clocks. With 10-foot faces and a 14-foot, 200-pound pendulum, the huge four-sided clock graced the tower of Old Cooley Hall at Cooley Farms in Warrensville Township. There it stood for almost 60 years, its 2,200-pound bell a constant reminder of the slowly passing time for inmates of the nearby Warrensville workhouse. Years passed, and Old Cooley Hall, having outlived its useful and in grave disrepair, was scheduled for demolition. The clock was up for grabs. Lakeland Board of Trustees Finance Chairman Arthur Holden remembers.
When we heard that there was a clock that would be available at a very nominal amount, we decided that we would acquire it. And so we sent trucks and people and whatnot and picked up the pieces. And when I say pieces, there were that was true. The pendulum had been dropped down and it was all twisted and bent, and there were gears that were missing. But there were some people here, good citizens, who knew something about antique clocks. So they were recruited to analyze the problem.
After careful examination of the clock, Cleveland Heights clock expert William Meather and other clock collectors determined that the clock could be restored. Lakeland's Engineering Technologies Department was called upon to design a system which would permit the clock to automatically rewind. New wooden hands were installed, just like the originals, but were eventually replaced with fiberglass. The wood absorbed moisture, thereby increasing the weight of the hands and influencing the accuracy of the clock.
And the biggest problem, as I remember, was getting another face, because we only had three faces, and of course we needed four. So, with the prospects of the clock being able to run and be of service, Then the question was where to place it. And obviously the designs for the building were completed, the construction was moving forward, and so we decided the only solution was to have a tower for the clock. With that decision made, we got Angie Angiteri, who had been the lead architect, and commissioned him to make a suitable design, which he did. And then it was a matter of raising some money to build the tower. And we fortunately had good connections with the contractors who've been working here, so we got a great deal of in-kind and materials without any cost to us. Then in addition, Ray Armington was a very good friend of many people here in Lake County, and so unbeknownst to him, we solicited some funding from his friends, whose names are all listed on the bronze plaque in the base of the tower. They came through in good fashion, and we had a pot of $50,000. There was only one problem in my mind at that point was, and I thought that the tower was a little stubby, that it should be at least 10 feet higher. So Angie said, "Art, if you go out and get me another $10,000, you can have 10 more feet of tower." Well, I didn't make it. So they went ahead with the construction, and at any rate, the tower is like it is today.
With a few minor changes in design and periodic adjustment, maintenance has been reduced to a manageable level, with many years of service.
It has all arbors and all separate bushings, and any bushing can be made and replaced. Even though you can't order it from Seth Thomas, you can still make it in a machine shop. I have a machine shop, so what breaks here, I just make. So you can put this clock back in new condition, you know, little bits at a time, or do it all at once if you want. But the wear is so slow that given any kind of maintenance 100 years from now, it's going to be ticking away up there.
Named in honor of longtime Lakeland benefactor Raymond Q. Armington, the 52-foot structure stands as a monument to a man who truly made a difference. His lifetime friend, Arthur Holden, remembers an early accomplishment.
In the early days, we had to build a college, and we had certain limited funds from the state. And the architects went to work, and they ended up with three sides of a quadrangle and one side open. So the trustees realized it would be much nicer if the fourth side of the quadrangle could be completed. And the man who was our finance chairman at the time was Ray Armington. And so his unexpectedly large assignment was to raise approximately $1 million to complete the buildings of the college. He faced up to it with courage and solicited the cooperation of a number of very nice people. One, for example, was Art Willey, who was just retired as chairman of Lubrizol. And another was Frank Jarvis, who had been an executive at Diamond Alkali. And so, by meeting regularly and with a little professional assistance from Jim Hardy, we managed to raise the $1 million.
Ray was probably the gentlest, most decent guy I ever knew. Bright, a prolific writer, was a significant influence in raising the private money that was needed to match some state money that came to start the campus and build the original buildings. He was generous. We needed money to renovate the Moorland Mansion roof, and we needed some thousands of dollars, and he gave half of it and convinced another friend to give the other half. I just really liked Ray Armington and hated to see him go.